On Larry King Now, Robert Wagner, the icon, reflects on Hollywood's golden age.
Larry, this was the greatest time of my life. They took me off the street, a green kid, knowing nothing, and they brought me into the studio.
You must have done very well with the women of this era.
You know, Larry, I tried as hard as I could, you know?
I married the same woman twice.
Yes.
You married Natalie Wood twice.
I did.
But why did we do that?
I don't know, but isn't it great?
It is. Plus, that was the bleakest period of the life, right?
Yes,
that had to be.
Absolutely.
How did
you
overcome it?
Well, I don't think you ever overcome it. And why should you?
All next on Larry King Now. Welcome to Larry King Now, our special guest, one of my favorite people, Robert J. Wagner, the iconic actor known for his roles in The Pink Panther, A Kiss Before Dying, one of my all-time favorite movies, Titanic, Heart to Heart, and more recently, the Austin Powers franchise and NCIS. His career has spanned more than five decades. In 2009, he penned his memoir, Pieces of My Heart, and he's now followed up with his latest, You Must Remember This, Life and Style in Hollywood's Golden Age, an ode to what may be Hollywood's most beloved era. I must ask you this. All your life, it was Robert Wagner. Everyone who knew you called you R.J.
R.J., yeah.
Why do you now add the J?
Why? They thought that looked pretty good, you know, the publishers.
But as an actor, it was always Robert Wagner, didn't it?
Yeah, always Robert Wagner.
On the screen, it didn't say J.
Yeah, I said to them, you know, I wanted to be billed by R.J. Wagner, you know, when I was under contract at the studio. And they said there's only one other person that goes by their initials, and that's K.T. Stevens, and she's not working, and you are. So good. I said, okay.
All right, why this book? You wrote Piece of My Heart. That was the memoir.
Mm-hmm.
This is more a book about things.
And
right?
I was on your show about that, and you were so gracious about it. Yeah.
Well, tell me about this.
Larry, this was the greatest time of my life. You know, when I got under contract to the studio, and I was 18 years old, and I caught the golden era just at the last. Just at the last. I met a lot of people that had created it, and It was just thrilling for me, and I thought.
So you grew up in it, though, right?
Yeah, I grew up in it.
You grew up here?
Yes, I grew up in Southern California, yeah, in Los Angeles. But you know, I have so many. I work with a lot of young people, and they ask me about the golden era. They ask me about that. What was that like? What was the contract system like? How did that happen? And they don't know anything about that. They don't know that Columbia had 20 young people under contract, and Fox had 30, and MGM had 40, and Warner's had 30, and all of these young, we were all young actors trying to get in the movies. You know, we were excited about it. They took me off the street, a green kid, knowing nothing, and they brought me into the studio.
What years were the golden years?
Well, I think probably they refer to it like 37, 38, 39.
Through
up till the studio started to break up. You know, I would say the late 40s it started.
And you broke in when?
I started in 1948. I was 18 years old.
So that was the end of that?
Yeah. I just caught the end of it. So, I tell them about it, and they say, what was that like? And I say, it was great because, you know, when I was under contract at 20th Century Fox, it was like being with a family. They took me in.
And the actors rooted for each other, right?
Oh, yeah.
They'd visit each other on sets.
Oh, yes.
Everyone wanted the other guy's movie to do well.
Yeah.
Because I remember this, because we spent time together, socialized with you. Spencer Tracy was a great part of your life, wasn't he?
Big time.
Put you in the movies.
He did. I was in the movies, but he asked for me to play his son in a picture called The Broken Lance. And he was so wonderful to me, you know, and he was considered the actor at that time, you know, the best actor. Then he asked for me to be on the mountain with him, and he gave me co-star billing above the title, and took me kind of out of the homogenized, being homogenized with a lot of young young actors. That were
what was it between you and him? What did he see, do you think?
Oh, I don't know. He liked me a lot, and I admired him so much.
Was he a grand guy as he was an actor?
He was great. He was great, you know. Larry.
I would love to have met him.
Oh, you never met him?
No.
Oh, too bad. Too bad. You would have liked him. Your kind of guy. Your kind of man. I went to Europe with him the first time. When we did The Mountain, we went to France together. Oh, it was great. I was on top. You know, it was the best time. It was the best.
I got to know later in life and became a great friend with Frank Sinatra, who was a great friend of yours.
Oh, yes.
And you write about Frank in the
yes,
book, right?
I do.
His
uh-huh.
parties and his love.
Yeah.
He was a complicated guy, was he not?
Yes.
Loyal to a fault.
Yes.
If he liked you, he liked you. But if he didn't like you...
Yeah, you know where you stood with FS, you know. You knew where you were with him. He was... so special to me, so kind, and do you know I was one of the people that gave his eulogy.
Yeah, I know, I was there.
And I miss him a lot, you know, he was great. He took me with him a lot of places, you know, I went to a lot of recording sessions with him, and I mean, I was so excited to be around him. I mean, you know that.
The Capitol Record
yeah.
building.
You know, you were with him, you know, You know the kind of a guy he was.
Oh, he. What were his? I've been at two of his dinner parties in Palm Springs.
Mm-hmm.
But he had great parties, didn't he?
Oh, super, super,
he
and
cooked.
Super guests. You know, Sammy, Dean, all those guys. Oh, it was great.
A lot of laughs.
Sensational.
A lot of drinking.
A lot of drinking. A lot of laughs.
Is it harder today, do you think, to break into this business?
I think so.
Because.
Because I don't think that. You know, when they took me in, I mean, they taught me voice, drama. Everything was available to me. I could do anything, you know.
But you had to do the movie they gave you, right?
Yeah, but why not? You know, I was in the movies. I was just happy to do anything. And I didn't mind that. They had some very good people around there that were making good decisions. They made great decisions about me. They took me off the street and made me a Bobby Sox idol. Hello?
What was your first film?
The first film I was in was called The Halls of Montezuma with Richard Widmark.
And World War II.
World War II. And also the leading lady in that was, we were later married, Marion Marshall. We had a child, Katie.
Robert J. Wagner, I love that.
You like that, huh?
Reflects on Elizabeth Taylor and most memorable roles. We'll be right back. The book is You Must Remember This. Are you taking that off the Casablanca
yes,
movie?
Uh-huh, yes. Yeah.
Robert J. Wagner, You Must Remember This. This book is guaranteed to be a major hit because it's about one of the great eras in American history. We're both talking, I'm 80, he's 84. Where did it all go?
I don't know, Larry, but you know, it's been great. It has been great. And I've been so fortunate. And when Scott and I started to investigate, look into this, and had this idea, all those places that I was involved in, the restaurants and the houses and many, many of the people, they're all gone.
When you drive around Beverly Hills now, what do you remember the people that I live on a street that I'm told Fred Astaire lived on. Right. I can't believe that.
Yeah, he built that house up there, and I was up there with him when he started to build it. He loved that house. I have a picture in the book that he gave me of him behind the bar. It's just one of his favorite pictures, and his horse triplicate is in the back.
What kind of guy was he?
The best, wonderful.
Married a jockey,
yeah.
Robin Smith.
Yeah.
She controls his estate.
Yeah,
tough.
I know that.
Elizabeth Taylor, you were pals?
Very much so. Yeah, I met her when she was like 14, and was one of the many people who was totally besotted by her.
Had purple eyes.
Oh, she was so beautiful, lovely, lovely woman.
You must have.
And one of the best actresses, you know.
Yeah.
One of the best film actresses that was around.
You must have done very well with the women of this era.
You know, Larry, I tried as hard as I could, you know. I tried.
You write in the book, you had a relationship with Barbara Stanwyck?
I did, yes. Well, I was in a film with her, Titanic. And
the first Titanic.
Well, no, there were a couple more. There was one more Titanic before the one we made. We made that one in 1952, I think.
But Clifton Webb?
Yes, Clifton Webb and Audrey Dalton and myself and Thelma Ritter. Wonderful cast. Lloyd Ahern. Oh, I mean, it was great. I fell in love with Barbara, you know.
It's understandable.
Oh, she was so wonderful. And to have the opportunity to, in my life, because I was younger than she was, but to be in love with an older woman. She was so
sexy,
great.
Sexy, right?
Huh?
Sexy.
Oh, she was so wonderful.
She wasn't beautiful. There was a look about her, though, right?
Yeah, she was such a wonderful lady. It was one of the most fortunate things that ever happened to me in my life because it turned everything around. And I really fell in love with her. And it was my first experience of being really in love. And she was just sensational to me. And I loved her very much. She was...
You start the book with an anecdote about Liza Minnelli's wedding, which the paparazzi press. That had to be the strangest wedding of all time with David Guest, right?
Yeah, it was.
I hosted their engagement party for some reason. I have no idea why.
You did?
I got roped into that.
Yeah. Well, it was an interesting time. You know, I must say, you know, she came. She was the maid of honor. And when she arrived, she had forgotten her shoes. So they had to go back to the hotel and get the shoes. So everybody was waiting. And she came in, and she was waiting in the priest's room for the shoes. And Michael Jackson was at her feet,
yeah.
You know. And they said to me, they said, go and get her out of there. We got to get the wedding started. And I said, well, why the hell me? You know, why? There's a lot of people here, you know. They said, well, you know where I am. So I go back there. And Michael is at her feet, gazing up at her. He, you know, he loved her. He was besotted by her. I said, Michael, we got to go. I love Elizabeth. I love Elizabeth. I said, I know, Michael. We all love Elizabeth, but we let's put her shoes on and get her going. It was a very interesting wedding. Nice, you know.
What a great career you've had. Oh, I mean, you look back at it. From this era into the whole era, and comedy, you were very comfortable with comedy. Yeah. But A Kiss Before Dying, I bring that up only because, is that the only time you played evil?
No,
you played a psychotic evil person.
That was a good role.
Ira Levin.
Yeah, Ira Levin, exactly. What a wonderful writer. He was a very, very nice man.
Whew, he wrote great books.
Oh, he did. My sister read the excerpt of that in Red Book magazine, I think it was in. And she sent it to me. She said, you know, I think you'd be wonderful in this part. And it turned into, I took it to the studio and they got Ira Levin. And he was so great.
Did you enjoy writing this? When you deal with memories.
Yeah, very much so. I did enjoy writing it. And Scott helped me so much, you know, because he knows Hollywood.
He's a historian, right?
Oh, yeah. He just finished the book on John Wayne, did the book on L.B. Mayer, C.B. DeMille, Ford. You know, he really knows Hollywood, and we become very good friends. And so we were able to talk this out and take it down the road a bit. And, yeah, I did enjoy it. I tell you what I had trouble with, Larry, was letting it go. I had a difficult time, you know, saying, okay, that's it. We've done it, you know.
Yeah.
That was difficult for me. But
up next, we'll talk about one of the great mysteries of his life, the incredible life of Robert J. Wagner. Who could have lived this life but him? We'll be right back. My guest is Robert J. Wagner. You must remember this. I can't wait to read this. You know, I glanced through it, but tonight I'm taking it home, and it will not leave my bedside because this is a page-turner, as they say. I mean, this is a wonderful... You worked with Charlie Sheen.
Yes, I did.
Television show. Yeah. What was he like to work with?
He was great. Total professional.
What did you make of when he got into all these problems?
I kind of was baffled by that, you know? I didn't know...
Did you talk to him?
No.
During that period? No,
no, no, no, I didn't. I didn't have the opportunity. I would have. He came up to where I live up in Colorado, and he likes to fish. You know, he's a fly fisherman. We were going to go fishing, and and have spent some time together, but I never had that opportunity. And, you know, when he's on the show, I mean, it was, you know, it's one right after another. He was great. I just enjoyed working with him so much. Couldn't have been better.
When you look at your life, you have to say, wow, right?
Oh, I do. I say thank you, thank you, thank you every morning, Larry, every morning. Can you imagine? I just finished NCIS, which was out, and I love doing that show with Mark and Harmon and Michael Weatherly. He's my illegitimate son.
Harmon may be the highest paid actor in television.
Really?
I think he's turned that series into a gold mine, hasn't he?
Well, it's been on for 12 years,
yeah.
And it's the most wonderful company I've ever worked with. I just can't tell you how much I enjoy going to work and how great they all are. You know, they all love each other, and I think that comes off.
Speaking of love, I married the same woman twice.
Yes.
You married Natalie Wood twice.
I did.
But why did we do that?
I don't know, but isn't it great?
It is, when you look back. I have to ask, so I'll let it pass, but I must ask you. They reopened the Natalie Wood thing.
Mm-hmm.
Did you ever comment on that?
No, I never did.
You wouldn't cooperate with the...
I had already cooperated with them, you know.
Yeah, you wrote it in your book.
Yeah, but there wasn't anything left to say, Larry. You know, when that accident happened, there were so many people on top of that, you know, at the time. You can't believe it, you know. But when that all came up again, it was so...
Were you shocked that the captain said that?
Well, it was rather transparent, you know. It was rather transparent. I hadn't seen him for a long time, and you know, he wasn't the captain of the boat. You know?
That was the bleakest period of the life, right?
Yes,
that had to be.
Absolutely.
How did
you
overcome it?
Well, I don't think you ever overcome it. And why should you?
Yeah.
Why should you?
It happened.
You know? But I had a great deal of support and help. I had my three daughters, who were right by my side, and later on, I was so fortunate because Jill St. John,
the best,
came into my life. Yeah, I know you love her.
I love her.
She came into my life, and she had her hand under my arm, you know, and through a lot of help from a lot of friends and a lot of people. It all came.
Why has that marriage to Jill worked so well?
Well, we've known each other for a long time, you know. We never were with each other romantically or anything like that. But, you know, she's there for me, Larry. You know, I don't quite know how to say. You know, she's just has been there for me and so close to me and so loving and so caring. And
do you feel 84?
No. I don't feel 84.
You don't look 84.
I don't feel 84, but I'm so privileged to be 84. I can tell you, I'm so happy. I'm very content now, Larry. You know, I mean, we all get hit. We all have tragedies in our life, big ones. And I was just very fortunate that I had some wonderful people around me. My daughters have been.
You also, frankly put, you're one of the best liked people in the business. I never heard a bad word about Robert Wagner. Huh. And even though you've had these romances, like, how do you think you've stayed above the fray? You have a quality.
Above the fray?
Yeah, but that, I mean, you've never been like the show business guy. You know, you're a guy's guy. I don't know why I'm praising you like this. I just enjoy your company.
Thank you very much. Thanks, Larry. That's very... Big compliment coming from you. I appreciate it.
What was life like in that golden era of Hollywood Boulevard and world premieres and stars and the restaurants? You mentioned the restaurants.
It was
the Brown Derby.
It was wonderful. It was a great period of time. And as I said, when I went back there, it was gone. You know, all that period was gone. But I tried to put it down. It was very special. One of the things that's very much different is that. There's a lot more people. You know, then it was more intimate, more Hollywood was royalty, and there were very few people. And they also protected us. You know, they protected it.
So everybody knew everybody there, right?
Oh, yes. And everybody was very encouraging to everybody. It wasn't, you know. See, today I think it's very difficult for young actors. They have to get a manager or an agent. go read for a part, find who's, you know, there's less pictures being made.
Also, you didn't have then paparazzi, right? I mean,
No.
You were treated as stars, and you treated almost, you were above the title.
Yeah, we came out of a restaurant, and if the photographer's there, they'd say, would you mind if we, would you give us a, could we get a shot with you? Sure, yeah, anything. They weren't allowed in the restaurants, you know, they were kept out of the restaurants. Today, they're free game, you know?
I mean, and with social network and with the life, there's no privacy anymore.
No, there's none at all.
Had that been then, it wouldn't have been, that couldn't have existed.
I think you're right. I think you're right. That's why I try to capture that, you know? And I never thought it was going to change. I thought it was going to be the same, you know?
Do you understand the Alec Baldwins of the world?
I do.
I do, too.
Absolutely. I think Alec, I understand him totally.
Robert will answer your social media questions in a moment. We'll play a game, If You Only Knew. The book, You Must Remember This. We'll be, nice picture. We'll be right back.
Thanks.
We're back with RJ, Robert J. Wagner, the book, You Must Remember This. We're going to play a little game in a while, If You Only Knew. But first, by the way, do you Twitter? Are you into all these social media?
No, I don't. I don't Twitter.
We have some tweets for you, however.
Oh, okay.
You know Jess on Instagram, your first job.
Well, I worked as an extra in the movies. Yeah, I worked for an extra for about a year.
Stand in scenes, you mean?
Yeah, for about a year I worked as an extra. Yeah.
At Hearts Freeway tweets, will there be more books with Scott? Any chance of another conversation with RW?
Yes. We're thinking about another book down the line here, but we may try to set that up and get it going. It's hard to get a book on these days, as
you're
well
not
know.
Kidding. It's a different world.
Yeah.
At Cookie Smith on Twitter wants to know if we'll see you again in NCIS.
I hope so.
What do? They let you know? Or?
Yeah, well, I'll be on. I will be on the show next year. They've got three more to do now, and I'll come back in and. Frank Cardia and George Skank are the producers, and they wrote that character for me, you know, and I love that character.
Skank's a great guy.
Oh, he is, and it's a wonderful role.
B.J. Thorson tweets, which changes in the film industry over the decades have been more exciting and challenging to deal with, both as an actor and producer?
Well, it's always challenging. It's always a challenging business all the way because... you know, I think now it's very challenging because, as opposed to when I started into it, because it's more corporate involved and more people are making decisions and committee decisions. It's difficult now, you know, to get a movie on, get financing, to get distribution. It's a big change.
A little game, If You Only Knew. We throw them out, you answer them, okay? First person you kissed.
The first person I kissed was a little girl called Dodie Booth.
Dodie Booth.
Yeah.
Where did it occur?
In Michigan. And I was
going. You from Michigan?
Yeah, I was born in Michigan. And I was going to this school called Brookside, and she was there. She was the cutest little girl.
How old were you?
I was about seven. Seven.
Yeah.
It was great. I loved it.
You ever find out what happened to her?
Yeah, she went on. She's married and, you know.
Oh, you know. What old Hollywood haunt do you miss the most?
I would say I miss Chasen's the most.
I almost felt that. I never
did
got
you feel
to,
it?
Never got to eat there, but when I went to Marvin Davis's house for dinner, he had the Chasen's people come over and cook their food.
You never ate there?
No. How great was Chasen's? It's now like a Whole Foods.
Well, it was the best. It was the greatest. And David Chasen and his wife, Maud, they were wonderful people. They loved everybody that came in. Went there a lot of times with Frank. You know, Frank loved that restaurant.
And Ronald Reagan met Nancy there.
Yeah.
Person you miss the most?
Professionally or is it personally?
I guess professionally.
Professionally.
Frank?
Yeah, I miss FS a lot because I had a lot of fun with him. And he was always so visible all the time. You know, you know that. And had some great times with him in the desert. And
what's a modern luxury you can't live without?
A modern luxury I can't live without. I like my iPad.
Oh, you do?
Yeah.
What keeps you up at night? What do you worry about?
You know, I worry. I'll tell you, I don't go to the bed with the news on. You know? I try to put some music on. I'm concerned. I have two grandchildren, and I want to be sure that they're going in, hopefully in the right direction. And they got a lot. I mean, young people today got so much
it's
intrusion.
It's a tough time to grow up.
Oh, it's murder. I mean, my little granddaughter, she goes in and she picks up the cell phone, and she's locked to it, you know?
Yeah.
And I'm trying to get her eyes. You know, I want her to look at me.
No, they can't. They don't. Characteristic you most value in others?
I like directness. I like somebody who is not entitled and somebody that can look at me and I can believe them.
Guilty pleasure.
Guilty pleasure?
Well, something you enjoy. Like, you like sweets. You like, what is a little pleasure you...
I like tequila.
You do?
Yeah.
That's a tough drink.
Yeah, it's a great drink, though. I like that.
I like a little Cabernet.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. Favorite dish of Frank Sinatra's?
Of FS's. Well, he had recipes to great sauce. He could make great pasta sauce. And I liked when he made pasta and great, you know, he had a variety of those.
Is there a TV show we'd be surprised to know that you watch?
No, I don't think so. I mean, I've watched kind of the current things that are on.
Would you rather time travel or space travel?
I'd rather time travel.
Any role you wish you could do over?
No, I don't think so. I mean, I gave it the best shot I had, you know, and I don't kind of look back. I'm trying to look forward and shed all of that stuff off of me, you know, and just kind of go directly on it.
One other thing, do you think about dying? I do, I gotta admit it.
Yeah, I do. I do think about that because I think about the people I'm gonna miss. That's what I think about. You know, that's what it really comes down to. Do you have that too?
Yeah, oh.
Larry, okay. Thank you so much. I appreciate your having me with you.
Oh, Robert J. Wagner, the book, You Must Remember This, available now. And remember, you can find me on Twitter @KingsThings. And we'll see you next time. I think I'm gonna cry.